it is used to detect algorithm. Okay, we have seen these examples already. Okay, yeah, now we'll go to the last point of this deadlock, that is recovery from deadlock. How can we recover from the deadlock here? So how do we do this? So this can be done with the different steps. One is to, first step is abort all deadlock processes. That means you stop automatically. So how we can abort this processes? So abort one process at a time until the deadlock cycle is eliminated. That means you try to select the processes which are entered into the deadlock state, and you take one by one, process by process, you abort it. So till the cycle which is formed as a deadlock will be eliminated. So then how we pick that? How do we pick the process? So should I pick in first come first serve or any random way? So we have some methods for that. In which order the processes should be aborted? First is priority of the process. See, if the process is high priority, then keep it as it is. If it is not, then pick the process for eliminations. Second is how long process has computed and how much longer to complete. That means till now how much time it has taken, and still it is how much time is required. So this can be used to abort. Next is resources the process has used. How many resources the process has used, that also can be taken. Then resources process needs to complete, still how many it requires, how many used, how many it needs. Then how many process will need to be terminated, still how many process can be terminated. Is the process interactive? Is it interactive means does it require always a process, that is processor, for execution or not? Check it out. Okay, then how we select it? So first we need to select a victim. Victim means which process does not require the processor attention always, or which process is waiting for a longer time. That means it does not require it. Its importance is not much. Then based on this, minimize the cost. Based on that, we can select the victim. Then roll back. So what we can do here, so we can restart the processes and give a some time for a process. If it is again given the cycle, if it again creates a deadlock, then that process will be terminated or aborted from the particular cycle. And the starvation, same process may always be picked as a victim. So if you can keep on picking up the same process again and again, starvation can also occur. This is a recovery from the deadlock. Okay, so now we can end up this chapter with these headings. How can we recover from the deadlock? Selecting a victim by rollback, and this leads to a problem, starvation. Okay, and I'll just open the next chapter. We'll see it. So I hope you all worked with all the examples of deadlock. That's most important. Now we'll take the next chapter called as memory management. So I discussed already in the class when I use the word memory management. So memory management always directly relates to the primary memory or main memory. So now we are discussing some of the techniques or how can we manage primary memory, that is main memory. Okay, that is about chapter number 8, memory management. So we'll discuss these headings in the coming slides. Okay, and let's see that some of the background of this chapters. So we know already that usually whenever we want to execute a program, where it must be brought, always the program must be brought into the memory and placed within a process for it to be run. That means to execute, a process should be brought. So where we can place all the processes in an input queue. We know already this. I think I told you already the ready queue. Collection of processes on the disk that are waiting to be brought into the memory to run the program. Okay. So we need to keep all those them. Then user programs go through the several steps before being run. That means before you want to run all those processes, they will undergo several steps. So we'll see now what are those like. Whenever you want to execute a program or a process, we will bind some of the instructions. So this binding can be done in different stages. That is, we call it the address binding. That means here, how we can get the address of the processes, how can we bind all of them and the data to the memory addresses. So it can happen in three different stages. First is during compile time. Second is during load time. Third is during execution time. That means address binding can take place in these times. Compile time, I mean whenever you want to compile the process prior to the execution. That means if memory location is known priori, that is absolute code can be generated. That means before you want to do, before you want to compile, then you can bind the addresses. Load time, so during loading of the particular code, if the memory location is not known, okay, then we need to generate that. We need to generate the some address during load time also, and also we need to generate the addresses during execution time. So binding delayed until runtime if the process can be moved during its execution from one memory segment to another. So during the running or execution of the particular process, we need to bind some of the addresses. So they can ask you for a brief question for a 4 or 6 marks. Brief note on different stages of address binding. So three levels or three stages they can ask you. So one is during compile time, other is during load time, and the last is other is during execution time. So after knowing this, we'll have to see the next one small diagram, how a process undergoes in different steps, multi steps. So it is your normal code, and this compiles, this code is compile time, and we generate the object module, and this will be linked with the linkage editor, and we load here, and the loader comes into picture into the memory for loading. So this is load time, and here execution time. I think we can see that compile time, load time, execution times. In all these three times, we will bind the addresses. I think you can see the diagram itself. This is multi-step processing of a user program. That means user program undergoes different steps when it executes. Now we'll see the two types of addresses which will be used most frequently in the system. So that is logical address and physical address. So what is a logical address? What is the concept of this logical addresses? So address which is generated by the CPU, that means which is generated by the processor, is known as a logical address. So during execution of a process, some address will be generated. So where you want to pick up particular instructions from the memory, then we need a some address that is generated by the processor or a CPU, that is known as logical address. What's a physical address? So after combining the logical address and some offset, I will see in the next diagrams, some offset and a logical address, combination of these two will get a particular physical address. That means the actual memory address from the physical memory or from the main memory or from the primary memory, the actual address seen by the memory unit where exactly you want to pick the data, because usually the data or instructions are stored into the primary memory for execution, right? So then you need to pick the instructions from the primary memory for processor for execution. So processor needs to know where the instruction is stored in the memory. For that, it generates two types of addresses, that is logical and physical addresses. Then how can we map this logical and physical? We'll see in the next slides. Okay. For that, we use a special unit called as memory management unit. So that is used to map the logical to the physical address, that is virtual to physical address. So we can call logical address is also as virtual address. Please remember this word, both are same. We need to map logical versus physical. Then we use some hardware devices, that is called as memory management unit. So here we use in the MMU scheme, we use some relocation register is added to every address generated by the user process at the time, and it is sent to the memory. And the user program always deals with the logical address. So it gets a particular physical address. So that's why it never sees the real physical address. That means it cannot see. It is automatically calculated and find the addresses by the processor itself, by the system itself. And you can see the diagram, how the dynamic relocation using a relocation registers, how can we do it out? So this is MMU, okay? And this is the logical address generated by your CPU. This is physical address. The base 14,000 is the base address of the particular process. What's the starting address of the process P1? 14,000. And now you're looking for some particular part of the process which has address of 346. 14,000 plus 346. What will you get? 14,346. So it will be somewhere in the memory. We will get the particular data for execution, because ultimately who needs the data? CPU needs the data, where the data is available in the primary memory. So how to get the data from the primary memory? We must map both the logical versus physical address. And in between mapping of this logical versus physical, we use a special unit called as MMU, that is memory management unit. Okay. So the dynamic loading is the one which we do it during the when we start running. This routine is not loaded until it is called. That means this some routines will be used. They'll be loaded until it is called. For better memory space utilizations, we will load dynamically. Otherwise, simply we are storing somewhere and for a longer time, we may not use memory effectively. That's why when you require, then you load it. That's called as dynamic loading. We'll see in the next call is dynamic linking. So this also some linking will take place during the execution call. Dynamically, some particular code or some stubs will be used to link. For example, see this linking postponed until execution time. Small piece of code, some stubs are used to locate the appropriate memory. So where they are there, when you want to link them, then you can do it dynamically. They are called as dynamic linking. So operating system need to check if routine is in process memory address. We'll see next another heading called as swapping. I think I talked about this word already long back to you. What is swapping? Swapping is nothing but temporarily moving some processes. Okay. Some processes from a primary memory to some other storage. Okay. That we call it as some storing point, back-to-back store. Okay. So temporarily moving out the some processes to some other memory, that process is known as a swapping. Again, that will be brought back. So when it wants to again execute, I mean, for some purpose, it will be swapped out. Again, it will be swapped in back again for its continuation of execution. So what we do here in this swapping here, so we can store back, that's backing store, roll out and roll in. So we will store back and again, we'll do this roll out and roll in. That is swapping variant used for priority based scheduling algorithm. I told you already, for example, if you're already in the temple, now you are about to visit the particular inside the temple. Okay. You want to take a darshan or whatever. Suddenly a priority process has arrived. Then you will be sent out from the temple for a while. It's not like permanently you are sent out, only for a while. You will be sent out from the temple because new process has come with a high priority. So until then, you are not allowed to take a darshan or visit the temple. Once the high priority process has completed the task, then you are allowed back. This is called as swap in, swap out. So you are swapped out when the high process has come. You will be swapped in back once that is completed. So this happens in the swapping process. That means temporarily you are moved out from the process, from the particular place, and again you will be called back for your continuation of execution. So that is known as a swapping. So you can see this how the swapping can take place with a diagram, schematic view of a swapping. So here this is your main memory. The topmost part is a operating system, and this part is user space. And here we are currently running with the two processes one and two. So what we do here, we are swapping out process P1 into some backing store. Some space it is. Okay. We are swapping out. And we are taking into the process P2 back into the user space for execution, because process P2 to keep in user space, there was no space. So we swapped out this. Now we are allowing process P2 into the user space for execution. Once